stuff right there.
In the back of that. There should be pens on your table. Nick, can you give me 3 minutes on the screen? I'm going to give you 3 minutes. It's going to count down, and I want to see how many answers you can get. And I just want to caution everybody, there's cameras everywhere. So we're going to know. You need not cheating before we get started. We're cheating. Okay, cheating's program. So we had it on the table, which is great. So thank you everybody for showing up. This conference is critically important for all of us.
Yeah.
Are we ready?
That's her husband.
Okay, is everybody ready? Is everybody ready?
Yeah.
Nick, let's start the clock. There we go. Gene, come on. Eugene, all the answers. I'm watching you. He's regretting that he met me.1 minute. How many people, by a show of hands, got 15 answers? Okay. How many got 10? How many people got 15 answers? How many people got 10? 5? 3? 1? How many people got 0?
I think they're going to raise their hands.
Everybody who's got a 0, keep your hands up. He was very happy to know that you got the correct answer. And I'm going to show you why. Nick, can we go to the video?
My name is Will Shorts. I'm crossword editor for the New York Times. This puzzle has a special story behind it. only one person knows all the answers. But she doesn't remember them anymore.
Alzheimer's is a devastating disease. We wanted to demonstrate its effects and show how the AFA can help. So we took a common hobby and transformed it into a way of experiencing the disease. First, we learned facts about patients' lives by interviewing their relatives.
My grandmother is Catherine. She had forgotten to feed the dog. She found a doll, named it. My dad's name is Richard. My name is Dad. Completely burned the fried chicken.
Then we had Will Shorts create puzzles based on each patient's life and the answers they can no longer find. We worked with the biggest newspapers in the United States to have the puzzles covertly published, making enthusiasts struggle to find the simplest answers. In addition to the newspapers, a range of media drove people online, where they could learn more about how the AFA can provide support. We showed the effects of Alzheimer's through a crossword puzzle that not a single person can solve. We reached over 5 million newspaper readers, a total of 50 million adding other media. AFA saw a 159% increase in web traffic, and another 62% in calls. And with unsolvable crossword puzzles, we helped many find the answers they needed.
So those of you who got zero, and all of you, have a greater understanding what this initiative was about. A couple years ago, I was approached by a healthcare public relations firm. First of all, my name is Chuck Michel. I'm not just the guy in the pink shirt that everybody keeps referring me to. I'm the president and CEO of the Alzheimer's Foundation of America, and I want to say thank you and welcome to our conference. And if you need anything, don't ask me. Ask Jeannie Turkheimer. Jeannie's right there. And you met Amanda on the outside, who will be doing our memory screenings today. But I was approached by a public relations firm. My office is in New York City. And by the way, I know the temperature's not great here, but this is like a heat wave for me. So I was approached by a healthcare public relations firm that said, we want to give back. We want to donate our services. And my motto is easy. If it's free, it's for me. But it's going to work for the foundation. So they said, we want to challenge people. We want people to go through for a period of time, just a brief couple minutes. We want them to experience frustration, confusion. And that's the whole intent of the Hardest Crossword. It's online. We're very proud of the work that we did with a company called Area 23. But for a brief moment, we couldn't solve the puzzle. You saw in the beginning Will Shorts. So if you don't know, Will Shorts is the editor of the New York Times crossword puzzle. And he joined on with us. And he was fascinated by the challenge. So the answers are of the lives of three individuals who are currently living with dementia. So give yourselves a round of applause for those who got zero. So before we get started with the program, I want to tell you a little bit about AFA. You'll see on the screens here what I'm going to talk about. It's our mission. Our mission is to provide help. Our mission is to provide support, to make sure people know that there's a place to turn to for guidance, counseling, and support. We were founded by a caregiver back in 2002, a gentleman by the name of Mr. Bert Brodsky. Mr. Brodsky is our founder. He's our board chairman as well to this day. In the 80s and 90s, his mother had Alzheimer's. No place to turn to, nobody talked about it. Before that, his parents were living in Florida. He's from New York as well. He noticed a change in his mom and dad, and he wanted to put a healthcare worker in the house to live there with him and take care of him. And his mother refused. She wouldn't allow him to do it. So he knew that there was something happening, and he's a person of action, very successful, self-made business person, who is a very successful entrepreneur throughout this country, who is very proud of the fact that he'll tell you that he grew up in the Bronx in a one-bedroom apartment with his mom and dad and his brother, and he shared the couch on the floor with his brother as a kid growing up. That's his parents there. He took the drastic steps, and he sued his parents. He took them to court in Florida, and
And when he walked into court, the judge said, Brodsky versus Brodsky, how much money is involved? And he said, Your Honor, there's no money involved. This is very emotional. It's terrible. I'm looking in the courtroom. My brother, my mom and dad are on the other side. You know, we're a close-knit family. So he told him what he wanted to do, and he looked at Mrs. Brodsky and said, he just wants to take care of you. Don't let the court make the decision. You know, make it yourself. So she did. They had a healthcare worker there. He brought both of them up to New York. And he tells me the story all the time that he would take his dad to the movies. Mom would be home with a healthcare worker, come back, you know, an hour and a half later, and she was yelling at him. He'd leave the kitchen, he'd go into the den, he'd leave the living room, go into the den, the caravan, and she would yell at him just in minutes. He never understood why. Because in the 80s and 90s, and even somewhat today, there's still a stigma attached to this disease, and that's why we're here. Nobody talked about Alzheimer's, they used words about it that we don't describe today, and we don't dare use. And after she passed away, he started to get better educated. And in 2002, he founded AFA as a national organization because he wanted to ensure that nobody goes on the journey alone because it was devastating to him, that he really didn't have any place to turn to. So since then, we've grown tremendously. One of our signature programs, and it's here today, is our national memory screening. Has everybody signed up for screening? Who's afraid to get screened? I was. You can raise your hand. If I can raise my hand, you can raise your hand. I did it at a New York City conference, but Mr. Brodsky did it before me. Now it's free, it's confidential. You're not supposed to talk about your score. He walked out, I went in. And he said, how'd you do it? I said, well, I can't tell you, it's free, it's confidential. He said, I hired you. How'd you do it? I asked him again, I said, well, how did you do it? He told me, I said, I did one less than you. Not that dumb. I'm sure they can do as well as him. But it's here today. Take advantage of the screenings. There's Amanda in the back. Amanda, just come forward. Wave your hand. Amanda, come on. There's Amanda. She will be doing the screenings today as well. Jeannie, who else is doing screenings?
Elaine from Visiting Angels.
And Elaine from Visiting Angels. Elaine, wave.
She's over you over there.
Doing the screenings now. So take advantage of it. It's 10 minutes, series of questions. You get a baseline. It's good to know. But we've trained more than 19,000 people throughout dementia training throughout the entire country and support and counseling tens of thousands of people. We are a member organization as well to provide our services. As we stand now, we're approaching 2,900 member offices nationwide. And what does that do? It gives our helpline, which is staffed by licensed social workers 7 days a week, a toll-free number to provide the support, counseling, and services that are critically important. Right here today, we have Down Syndrome Network of Arizona and Visiting Angels. They're right in the back. Take advantage of their services. Get to know them. They're absolutely terrific people. Some of our programs and services are on our website. I ask all of you just to take a look at our website, alcfdn.org. You can see webinars, teleconferencing. All the information is on there that you need to know how to take care of a loved one. Why get screened? The question is, why not? Why not? You know, if you're sitting here and you go through the conference and you're a little apprehensive right now, just talk to Jeannie, talk to Amanda, talk to Elaine, and they'll talk to you a little bit about the screening. It's critically important. It's important that you get that baseline. If you have any concern about your memory, or if you don't, just take a look at it. Because not all memory issues are attributed to Alzheimer's. You know, so many times I hear from my friends, now that I'm in this position, I just finished my fifth year as the CEO of this great company. Sometimes they forget something. I have Alzheimer's. I can't find my keys. I said, well, if you find your keys and you don't know what they're for, then you should address it. If you see a change in a loved one's behavior, don't just think because they're aging that that's common, he or she is getting older, because Alzheimer's is not a normal part of aging. And you're gonna hear a lot more about that from Dr. Denborough when he comes and he's our speaker today. But sleep apnea, there's so many issues, depression, thyroid issue, vitamin deficiency, all attribute to memory loss. But if you don't get them checked out, you'll never know. Part of our mission is to give back. 88 cents of every dollar that we receive in donations, we give to our programs and services. And 100% of donations that come in are dedicated solely to research for better treatment and cure. And you can see on the screen, we're funding research all over the country, as far as from New York all the way to Israel. We are funding research at the Hadassah Hospital in Jerusalem. We're very proud of the work. It's part Part of our mission to support our member offices, we offer 5 grant cycles a year, and we make sure that we give money to support the programs and services that are so critically important that they serve throughout the entire country. We have a public policy office in Washington. Very proud of the work there. We advocate for more money for caregivers, and we advocate for more money for research as well. Right now, for the first time, the federal government has appropriated more than $2 billion for research. Sounds like a lot of money, and it is a lot of money, but a clinical trial can take and cost $800 to $1 billion, and it has, it can have a failure. Unfortunately, right now, 99.7% of the trials that have been going on in the last decade have failed. But we never stop, and we don't give up. And you can see the cost of care. And this is why we have a public policy division in Washington. A few years ago, to heighten the awareness of Alzheimer's throughout the country, we created Light New Nation. It grew so fast in 4 years that we now have buildings, historical landmarks, all over the world, Shanghai, United Kingdom, all over the United States and Canada, that light up in teal. And this year it's gonna be November 7th. We're very excited about that as well. So why are we here today? Why are we doing the National Educating America Tour? Well, 2 years ago, we celebrated our 15th anniversary, and I wanted to do something that was different. So we embarked on this National Educating Tour Concepts and Care Conference. To date, we've over 25 states that we visited. But if you look at the figures, you look at the statistics, more than 5 million people are living with Alzheimer's disease, and right here in your own state, more than 140,000 people. It certainly justifies why we're here. The only thing I would love to hear the federal government say, I think people are afraid to say, this is a national epidemic. It has to be taken a lot more serious than it has been in the past. More money needs to be supported for caregivers, and more money needs to be supported for research. These are some of the states we'll be visiting this year. We're very proud of the work. Tonight, after the conference, I think at 4:30, 5 o'clock, Jamie, we're flying to Denver. We have a conference this Thursday in Denver, heading to snowstorm. It's never going to snow in New York. I bought a snowblower 2 weeks ago. Never going to snow. Let's break my garage. I take it out every weekend. I start it. My wife thinks, I'll put this guy out there in the driveway again, starting a snowblower with no snow. So I want to thank our supporters, our exhibitors, and right here, some great people right here, these 3 tables back here. Marsha's going to be speaking. She's from Fraser, Ryan, Goldberg, and Arnold. Senior helpers and visiting angels. Get to know them. Get to know the programs and services that are so critically important to you as caregivers, as individuals that came here and want to be educated. I want to thank our supporters and our sponsors that allow us to put on this conference. We don't charge anybody for our conferences. We want to ensure that everybody has the opportunity to be here. New York City, where we have an education and resource center, we provide therapeutic community-based programs. We don't charge anybody. We want to make sure that people are not denied the services that are so critically important. And our goal, and I always say this to my staff, it's with great respect, it's never enough. Because the disease is so prevalent, the support for caregivers is so critically important. So I want to thank you so much for being here. Join with me in giving yourselves a round of applause. So we have a great lineup today, and I'm delighted with the speakers that are here. Jean Turkheimer is our National Membership Coordinator. She's going to come up right now and introduce our next speaker. But before we do that, I'm going to show you a video. It's called Uncle Sam. It talks a little bit about the services and what we do at AFA.
My last 8 years in the city, and my brother's last 11 years in the city, we took Sam out to lunch once a month. We had a routine, we meet him at the diner around the corner from his apartment, and the first time it was really dawned on us that there's an issue is when he didn't show up. We were scared, we were running around, and then we finally went and saw him in his apartment, he just forgot about it. And from then it was kind of like progressed really like downward spiral to that. Cooking and forgot to turn his stove off. And at that point it was, we have a real issue here and we need to start looking for resources to help us navigate through this and figure out a solution for him. Sam was a young boy when the Holocaust broke out. He was living in Poland with his family. He was brought to 3 or 4 different death camps and was able to survive all of them.
Concentration camps.
He's living a wonderful life. really troubled when you're watching someone losing their mental capabilities, and they're losing their memories, and they're losing who they are as a person. It strips everything that you've built an entire life for and everything you became, and it turns you into someone that you're not. It's a debilitating disease that it's going to affect you, and it's going to change the person that you are, both mentally and physically. And it also has a great effect on your family members, because it's very difficult to watch someone that you love go through such a tough time. He probably written his life story 35 times. I think it's because he doesn't want people to forget what he's been through. And it's just so ironic that as his disease has taken over his life, you know, he started to forget his own memories. And so here it starts, and it's talking about him and his life, and then we're a third of the way through the book, and he starts over. And so he writes his name, and he was born on December 1st, 1922, and then it goes through his whole story once again. Told me he was scared. He knew he was starting to lose it and his memory was starting to go. He was vocal to me and said, you know, I need help. And I need to get out of my apartment, and I can't live by myself anymore. Dancing is, it's his pleasure. Dancing to the music is what Sam, it makes him happy, it makes him tick. He used to be very active. He was always going to the senior centers in the city. He was around people, he was dancing, he was happy, he was loving life. So where Sam is now, he can't dance anymore. He hasn't been dancing for the last year. And the hope is when he moves into the facility, he'll be able to start dancing again. And having a network of people to tap into, the Alzheimer's Foundation, they introduced me to a group of nurses that have been able to take care of my uncle. You know, for a man that's been able to, you know, beat almost everything else, to know that this is one he ultimately isn't going to be able to beat, it's tough, but there's hope. There's hope for him to find a cure. There's hope to make the rest of his days sound better. What I think will make his life more enjoyable is getting into an assisted living facility, where they have the tools and resources to help people in this situation. No matter what hand you're dealt, it's really your attitude and the way that you go through life that's gonna, you know, ultimately decide the way that you live your life. And as long as we keep on fighting, there's hope.
Hey, all right, it works. Good morning. I didn't know which way to get up here. I was kind of like, should have come in that way. That would be better. Or just came right up the front. It's so nice to see everybody here today. I really, really appreciate it. And let me just get oriented. This is the clicker, and I'm assuming it advances forward if I just click this huge button. So I can't mess it up. I wanted to thank the AFA for having me here today. I have about 45 minutes or so to speak, and about 15 minutes to ask questions or to answer questions, but I'd like to, if you guys are okay with it, I'd like to do it sort of less talk, more question and answer. Sound better? All right, great. Well, you haven't heard me talk, so how can you say that? I'm a little ADD, and so I don't like, as you probably already noticed, I don't like standing behind the platform. I like moving around. So if you are over there, I might be over here at some point, and vice versa. And just kind of bear with me. It just helps my brain work a little bit better by walking around. So a couple things that I wanted to just get out of the way at the beginning. I wanted to thank you all for being here. Last year I did the keynote address here, and it was really well attended. This year is better attended than it was last year, I think. And I wanted to thank you all for that, for being here. I'm kind of a, this is considered weather for all the East Coasters that are here. This is considered weather for Arizona. So thank you for braving it out. And two, I wanted to thank all the people that are here that are lending their resources. And I wanted to encourage you to really form community here, to break isolation, and to really talk about this disease in a way that's very open and very, I guess, without stigma. And that's my goal today, is to sort of talk to you about breaking down the stigma associated with dementia and Alzheimer's. So what I'm here to do is I'm going to talk to you today about the state of the state. Now, I'm kind of crazy. Some of our team for Smart Brain Aging is here, and they'll tell you how crazy I am. But the talk is actually titled The State of the State of the State. And that actually makes sense in my own mind, because it's the state of dementia, not just Alzheimer's type dementia, but the state of dementia in the state of Arizona at present. So when I go to Colorado on Thursday, I'm going to be talking about the state of the state in Colorado. But Arizona is sort of a, I didn't grow up here, but it's sort of a home state for me. I've been practicing here for the last 12 years. I formed our company here, and I love being here because it has a great synergy of biomedical resources, but it also has a really, really terrific synergy of people that are older, that are aging, that are going to, fortunately or unfortunately, are going to triple to quadruple the dementia population in the state of Arizona in the next 10 years. So we talked about dementia being an epidemic level disease. So if you take the other, I'm gonna give you some startling statistics. If you take the other top nine epidemic-related diseases worldwide, and you combine them, they do not hit the level that dementia costs individuals and costs us as a society. So we'll be talking about that a little bit more today as well. And you all have slides that you can take notes on, and if you like, you can always email or call me, and I'll have my contact information at the end, okay? All right, let's see if this sucker works. So thank you for the AFA for having me here. And maybe I'm pushing the wrong button. Green button?
The big green button?
Yep. I'm actually pushing that
one. No, you're pushing the other green button.
No. See? Oh, yeah, you, I am. This is the bigger green button. You're right. It is the big green button. All right. So I wanted to dedicate this talk and dedicate all my talks to my grandmother. And her name is Jean Ellen Sealing. And she passed away in 2013. And I want to tell you a little story about my grandmother. My grandmother is a, or she was a strong, what we would call a strong independent woman. She's the kind of person that would, you ever heard the saying, call a spade? Yeah. She would tell it like it is. She was very astute, very high in her high school. She was one of the first women of her generation to go to college. She broke a lot of barriers. As she got older, we started noticing that she was having some small, subtle decline. And we started addressing to her. We said, "Grandmother, would you consider getting your brain checked?" And she said, "No, I'm actually doing fine." Sound familiar? Yeah. All right. She said, "No, I'm actually doing fine." And I said, "Well, actually, Grandma, I'm studying this." And I was in Montana in graduate school, and I was going across the country, and I had all my stuff packed up in a car to go to internship at Harvard University in about 2004 at the VA Boston Healthcare System. And I said, "Grandma, this is a pivotal time. You're starting to show some subtle signs of this problem. We need to get it addressed as soon as we possibly can." All right, these conversations turned into arguments, and it was really hard for me to have these kind of conversations because I knew exactly what was happening, even though I had not quite gotten my PhD yet. And I said, "This is what's gonna happen if this continues." And eventually, I gave her some brain exercises to do, and when I came back every 6 months or every year to visit her in her apartment at an independent living center, they would sit at the same place every time gathering dust. Or she would pretend like she was using it, but she wasn't. I said, "Grandma, this is exactly the time. We have to do something now. We can't wait any longer." She said, "Honey, I'm just too old. Now, in that example, I tell that story not because that story is unique. I tell that story because I actually think it's not unique at all. Because when I speak to hundreds of thousands of people in the last 10 years, that story has resonated with almost each and every person that I tell it to, because it's not unique in any way. What it shows is our two primary myths associated with aging. One, that dementia is just something that happens as we get old. Now, you are sitting here today because you're interested at some level in doing something about this disease, or I hope you are. But we wouldn't say that heart attacks are just something that happens as we get old, right? That seems absurd. But we want to see that diabetes or hypertension or high cholesterol is just something that happens as we get old. No. This is actually something that just happens to be a disease that we in our minds don't treat as a separate disease. And I want to really hammer that home. I'm not a philosopher, although I play one on TV. No. I'm not a philosopher, but I just want to hammer that point home. Is this doesn't just happen to you and to me. This happens to neuropsychologists. This happens to dementia experts. This happens to everybody. These kinds of conversations that we have with our loved ones. So when we're talking about getting a memory screen, that just has to happen. Because you wouldn't be like 60 or 65 and say, "Oh, I don't just go to the doctor at all. I don't get my blood pressure checked." Because I just want to confront you, if that's what you're thinking, I want to confront and actually say that that's the attitude that one person is displaying if they don't get their memory checked as they get older. And maybe I'm sort of speaking to a like-minded audience, but I just want to really reaffirm that. It's that this is a separate disease that we need to treat philosophically, and we need to treat culturally as a separate disease. Make sense? Okay, so this talk is dedicated to my grandmother. We lost her before she physically died. And maybe you had the same experience. It's a terrible, terrible, terrible experience. And this film that Netflix has been producing for the last 3 to 4 years highlights myself, my mother, our family, and it's a tribute to my grandmother, but mostly what it is a tribute to everybody that has gone through this terrible disease and a call for people to again reduce stigma to get out there a bit more. 60 million people worldwide had diagnoses of dementia or dementia-related illnesses. 60 million people. So many people often ask me, what is the difference between Alzheimer's and dementia? Dementia is just this umbrella term of which Alzheimer's is a type of dementia. So when I do talks, I talk about dementia because I'm really interested in all different types of dementia. Alzheimer's, Lewy body, Parkinson's, vascular, mixed dementias, all different forms of which there are more than 20 different types. You'll hear me talk about dementia. The terms Alzheimer's disease and dementia should not be used synonymously. Dementia, the umbrella term, Alzheimer's being a specific type. Kind of like saying cancer being an umbrella term. And let's just say a type of cancer, bone cancer, being a specific type. 60 million people have diagnosis of dementia. That's approximately one person per minute. And this is expected to triple in the next 10 years. Does anybody know? I've been doing a good job staying on the stage for so long, but I'm feeling really antsy about it. So I'm going to step down. This is expected to triple in the next 10 years. Does anybody know why?
People are living longer.
People are living longer. That's one piece. Yes, people are living longer. That's been true. So longevity of life is increasing. Yes, miss. Poor diet, potentially, yes, but it's not necessarily totally responsible for this increase. This is gonna get really dangerous. What do you call it?
Laser.
Laser.
Yeah, the original one you were pressing.
Oh, yeah, here we go. Yes, look at that. Nice. All right. I promise that point to the audience. All right. So this is, thank you. So this is expected to triple in the next 10 years. Anybody else? Thoughts, Jeff?
We now understand a lot more about the disease so it can be better diagnosed where 20 years ago it wasn't.
Absolutely, so more disease identification, for sure, absolutely. There's another reason, a big reason that you're missing so far, yes, in the red. Alcohol-related, potentially. I love these answers. Yeah, who said that? Yeah, miss. What's your name? Pat said the baby boomer generation is aging into the range of dementia. So you have a lot of factors that are happening here, as you all mentioned, that where people are aging in to the range of dementia. So you know that in the state of Arizona, there is a projected 44 to 72% increase in the rate of dementia in the next 10 years. I just want to highlight that again, and I'm going to use the laser. 44 to 72% increase in this disease in the next 10 years. Why in Arizona in particular? We have a lot of people that are in that age bracket. And quite frankly, I don't want to make assumptions, but many of you are actually here today that are aging into this bracket. We are at ground zero for the development of dementia. This is not hyperbole, we are on the front lines of dementia identification. In dementia, I think, I use the term a lot, mitigation. So if I just want to I just want to underscore this. I just want us to take a moment, and I don't want to browbeat you here. If somebody was doing a talk on heart disease, and they said there was going to be a 44 to 72% increase in heart disease in the state of Arizona in the next 10 years, this would be front page Arizona Republic. This might even be front page national news. We have a big problem in awareness that this is not front page state news right now. Because when I go over the statistics, and these are not hard to find, I'm not a very smart person. I know my area, that's it. These are very obvious statistics and obvious economic and personal repercussions associated with this disease. So we must keep in mind this is an urgent, urgent matter. This is a national pandemic level disease. It's a pandemic level disease. And our state of Arizona is the most affected area in the world from an increased perspective. Not a sheer numbers perspective, but an increased perspective. So this is very, very significant. Very significant. There's 600,000 confirmed cases of dementia in the United States alone. When I traveled to China, I did last May, there is a huge interest in dementia in China, India, and Japan. A big aging population there. Approximately 23 million people have confirmed the cases of dementia. Now again, we're talking about dementia, right? What are we not talking about? Well, they say Alzheimer's is grouped under that umbrella, but what else are we not talking about? I'll talk about it here in a second. The cost, but this number does not even scratch the surface of how many people are actually affected. Because what we should be entering conversations about, and what I'm going to turn this talk into today, if you don't mind, is to talk about what you get before you get dementia. Something called mild cognitive impairment. So this number, if you look at it and you think that's a huge number, just think that that number is about 1/5 of the actual number of people that may have dementia-related problems, ultimately. This is a staggering, staggering disease, and only gets more staggering the more you research it, the more you know about it. 1.5 billion people or greater than 1.5 billion people on Earth are affected in some way, directly or indirectly, by dementia. This costs us $1 trillion. When I see those numbers, I can't even fathom it. It doesn't even compute in my brain. And this is expected to increase 4 times internationally in the next 10 to 15 years. Okay? So I've laid on the statistics pretty heavy for you now. Let's talk about what this means locally for us. A 50 to 75% increase in the state of Arizona, costing the state $350 million in direct and indirect costs. And I can assure you that this number is a tremendous underrepresentation of costs. There's over 250,000 people in the state of Arizona that are affected, that have confirmed diagnosis of dementia, and this affects our independence, our dignity, and our time. Now, when I talked to my grandma later in life, there was a couple things that she wanted. She didn't want to be a burden to anybody else. Sound familiar? And she wanted to preserve these three factors: independence, dignity, and time. When I talk to my clients, my patients, these are the three factors that they want the most. They want to preserve their independence, their dignity, and their time. I'm going to talk about today ways that we can do that. So stroke, heart disease, prostate cancer, we hear a lot about these on the news, right? My dad had prostate cancer, so I got my prostate checked for the first time about a year ago. Now that I just turned 40 a couple years ago. And these things are all down. They all reduced. Dementia went up 123%. But we wouldn't know that if we looked at the publicity about these things, right? This is why groups like the AFA are so important to endorse. It's so important to go to these talks. It's so important to have a grassroots movement about dementia, because this is the stuff that allows people to have more conversations, allows people to get more publicity on this particular area. Super, super vital. So what exactly is dementia? Dementia is a progressive neurobiological disorder, so that means it just happens to get worse over time, and it affects one's ability to think correctly. Now, it results from atrophy or shrinkage of the brain. It results from plaques in Alzheimer's type dementia. It results from tangles of nerve cells getting tangled with one another. Sometimes in vascular or mixed dementia, it results in mini strokes, and there's a loss of a chemical in the brain called glutamate. And we'll talk about glutamate here today. Dementia is technically not a disease, but a group of symptoms. And we talked already about the difference between Alzheimer's disease, Alzheimer's type dementia, and dementia in general. Alzheimer's being a type of dementia. And there are other types. So what happens in a neuron is these neurons are like chemical messengers. They're like wires that proceed from all throughout your brain. There are more neurons in the brain than there are stars in the sky. And inside a healthy neuron, you see that this tube of sorts is intact, right? When you get a diseased neuron, this neuron becomes non-intact. It cannot transmit messages from one end to the other. And that's a big problem, because if you can't get messages from one end to the other of your electrical wire near your house or your TV wire, then you're not getting a signal, you're just not getting communication, right? And so that's one of the main things that happens during dementia, is people develop, in Alzheimer's, they develop protein deposits, they develop different forms of plaque, they develop tangles of these neurons, and that contributes to the problem in getting the message from one end to the other of these neurons. And so if you look at somebody with Alzheimer's type dementia, you have these type of cells in the brain, where there's these plaque deposits, and then here you have these healthy cells. And what happens is the nerve cell ultimately dies. Now, you see this graph? There are striations, and you see the striations going from one end to the other, and they kind of basically look like, with some disruption, they look like consecutive striations. And then you look down here, this is a diseased axon. This is where you lose communication. You lose signal, and it is an electrochemical signal. So this is ultimately what happens in dementia. This is sort of dementia 101. You may already know this, you may not. So one of the main things that I study is the shrinkage of the brain. So if you look at a healthy brain, you see how big this brain is? This brain here is two-thirds the size of this brain. Two-thirds the size. In volume. And what happens is there's ultimately a shrinkage due to the lack of a particular chemical or a series of chemicals in the brain ending in a chemical called glutamate. So we're going to go back to that, but this is about two-thirds the size of somebody with a normal brain. So what do we do about this? I talked to you about one of the major myths I mentioned earlier in the presentation, right? I talked to you about my grandmother thinking that dementia was just something that happened as she got old. And also what I didn't tell you is her doctor, and I'm not faulting doctors here, but her doctor at the time said that she did not have dementia. Her doctor at the time didn't screen her. Her doctor at the time didn't do any testing, didn't do an MRI of the brain, and didn't want to enter into a hard conversation with her about the fact that she was declining. So one of the things, and I'm not faulting primary care physicians here, they're in a difficult situation of having direct conversations with people about a very, very significant issue in which they often don't do the proper testing, they often don't do the proper imaging, and they often don't get the proper diagnostic workup for people early enough. And I think, honestly, I think it's because they have difficulty entering into difficult conversations with patients who are often very resistant to this process. So I'm not faulting them, I just think that that's a problem. So one of the major myths that we talk about when we talk about dementia is that by simply doing brain activity, will be helpful in helping prevent the decline associated with dementia. Now my grandmother used to do the New York Times crossword puzzle, speaking of the New York Times crossword puzzle. She used to do the New York Times crossword puzzle up to about stage 2.5 of dementia. There are 7 stages. She can play bridge. She can do almost all the things that she normally can do until the end when she stopped doing them. The major myth, other than dementia synonymous with aging, is by simply doing brain activity, this helps prevent dementia. We have to do things that we have never done before. We have to do new and novel brain activity. How often, realistically, do we actually do that? Do we actually do something that we've never done before? So this idea came to me, it wasn't just to me, but when I was in a lab in Boston, this came to me, this process of new and novel learning. And this process was found to release more glutamate in the brain. Do you remember that chemical glutamate that we talked about? And that glutamate served to reduce the atrophy of the brain. So this is the part of the talk, just to let you know, this is the part of the talk where hopefully, I see people become a little bit more emboldened and a little bit more hopeful. Because I hammered you with some pretty sobering statistics. And hopefully I put a mild amount of fear in you, enough fear in you that you will change. So I'm gonna tell you now how to change. And if you want to cure dementia, I'm just gonna be real with you, you're gonna have to wait about 25 to 30 years at least. 99.5% of clinical trials have failed for drug therapy. There is no known reversal, despite these ads you might see on TV, or the insane predatory marketing that occurs to your generation. No cure, nowhere close. Are we getting closer? Somewhat. Are we moving in the right direction? Yes. but we are at least 20 or 30 years away from being cured. I tend to think that we will cure cancer before we cure dementia. We have much better imaging technology associated with cancer than we do with dementia. So what I talk about in my company, and what I talk about when I do talks, is that I talk about mitigation. Mitigating the intensity of the disease. Reducing the intensity. Reducing the severity of the disease. Delaying the onset of the disease. Can we do that? Absolutely. And the way we do that is through novel learning. Doing things that we have never done before with our brains. This leads to an increase in glutamate. This leads to more of a process of normal aging and mitigation of this decline. What does not work are these repetitive games. So if you're already doing crossword puzzles and you do them all the time, it doesn't work. If you are playing bridge, you already know how to play bridge, that does not work. I'm sorry. Just want to be honest with you. That doesn't work. You have to do something that's incredibly new and incredibly novel. In order to release more glutamate, you have to vary this routine. And you have to vary this routine consistently. You need to develop a mental workup that includes diversity and then includes novelty. And that will help prime your brain for the release of glutamate that actually happens during stage 4 REM sleep, when you dream at night. You need to do that 3 to 4 times a night. So what doesn't work right now are medications. Have you heard of these medications?
Yes.
Namenda?
Yes.
Aricept? Exelon? You may have known, you may not have known that the drug companies that make these drugs recently discontinued the research behind them because the research was found to be so ineffective. These drugs work at about 5% maximal efficacy only at the very early stages of the disease. 5% maximal efficacy. Only at the very early stages. Often they are not prescribed at the early stages. So what is helpful? This idea of doing brain exercise. The idea of doing brain exercise is a good one, we just don't do it right. So this idea of cognitive prevention and intervention for mild cognitive impairment is a relatively new one. I've been working on it for about 10 or 12 years, but this idea of doing the right cognitive prevention and intervention is a relatively new one overall. So it's doing the right kind of brain exercises with the right population to make sure that we can actually help prevent this disease. And I'm going to talk about that here in a second. So again, cost of dementia. The total estimated worldwide cost of dementia is $604 billion, across about 1% of the gross domestic product. And if dementia care were a country, it would be the world's 18th largest economy, ranking somewhere between Turkey and Indonesia. By 2030, worldwide societal costs are projected to increase 85%. 85%. So when I'm a grandfather, this landscape is going to look much, much different from a societal perspective. Our society will be much older overall, and will be much more affected at a personal and societal level by this disease. How many people, you don't need to raise your hand, but are there, I guess you can if you like, are there caregivers here? Awesome, that's great. Okay, so caregivers, is more than 16, thank you for coming. There's more than 16 million family members and other unpaid caregivers that provide an estimated $18.4 billion in care. And the care ultimately is valued in loss of working hours, is valued at more than $232 billion. In 2018, the total cost will be about $277 billion. when you look at healthcare, long-term care, and hospice service. Now, somebody said that this, we are also dealing with the longevity of life. We are dealing with an increasing cataclysmic trajectory of increasing longevity of life without doing anything to help project quality and independence. So life expectancy and dementia is a main area of focus. So what is the scientific literature on cognitive intervention for mild cognitive impairment and vascular cognitive impairment? Well, there was a guy named Len Smith who was at Mayo prior, and he did a presentation, and it's found that basically a lot of research studies demonstrated positive results. So if you combine cognitive intervention and family support, that's found to result in delaying somebody's institutionalization and perhaps the death of a person receiving care. What I think people should do, this is my take on things, what I think people should do is I think people should have a general intake evaluation. They should have a neurological assessment by a neurologist. They should have a neuropsychological assessment. They should have a team conference, and they should also have cognitive intervention for mitigation of this disease. So doing the right kind of brain exercises, and the research tells us that we only need to do this 1 to 2 hours a week. And this should be followed over time via these serial neuropsychological assessments and this feedback to family. But the key is to get these people early. When is the best time to work with people with dementia? Before it even is noticeable. During the normal aging process. That's the best time to work with people with dementia, during this normal aging process. So early detection, yes? What age is that? So for most people, I think it's between 65 and 70 years old. Is that people should start getting general baseline assessments at the ages of 65 to 70 years old. You know, you go on Medicare at 65, many of you know that, right? You get an annual wellness exam. Now they're starting to do a cognitive portion of that annual wellness exam. They should do more. They should refer to a neurologist. They should refer to a neuropsychologist. This should be a standard part of practice for anybody in this particular area. And I think you should be followed once a year from 65 on with a 2-hour Medicare reimbursable neuropsychological examination. 0 out-of-pocket cost to you, 2 hours of your time once a year. And if there's any abnormality, we would be able to detect it prior to it converting from mild cognitive impairment, or prior to converting from normal aging into mild cognitive impairment.
What type of practitioners are qualified to do that kind of assessment?
Yeah, so the question was, what type of practitioners are qualified to do this assessment? Mainly neuropsychologists. So the problem is that, again, not to fault primary care providers, but the problem is that you go to your primary care provider and they say, you're doing fine. Yeah. And you say, well, I heard this crazy guy on Tuesday morning talk about that I should get my brain checked even though they're not having any problems. And they'll probably say, well, you don't need to get your brain checked, you're not having any problems. What I'm saying is that this is exactly the time you get your brain checked. Yes? The question was, what genetic basis does dementia have, or Alzheimer's have? You are more susceptible if you have a genetic relation, a person in your family that has dementia, or that had dementia, particularly Alzheimer's type dementia. You're more with two parents than you are with one parent. There is a genetic basis for Alzheimer's type dementia. Vascular dementia is more diet related. but there is a genetic basis for Alzheimer's type dementia. So early detection is a huge, huge ask. Yes, Miss. Yeah, there's a question, is there any place you can go to if you're prior to age 65? And I also thank you for saying that, because commercial insurance does cover this as well. They cover neuropsychological examination. So yes, there is, there are plenty of places that there, that's actually more than a few places that you can go, and I'll give you some resources here in a second. So if you want to get involved, here are some steps that you can take. One step is through the Alzheimer's Prevention Initiative. Have you guys heard of the Alzheimer's Prevention Registry? It's here in town. This is an international collaboration towards the prevention of Alzheimer's. Clinical trials to aim the prevention of dementia in healthy individuals that are at genetic risk for Alzheimer's type dementia. There's 216,000 people that are registered, so check out the Alzheimer's Prevention Registry. Again, I think, and I'm not alone in this, I'm not the only crazy person out there that thinks this, we should impact people at normal aging prior to getting into the mild cognitive impairment, vascular cognitive impairment area. Now again, what is mild cognitive impairment? It's the thing you get before you get dementia. The thing you get before you get dementia. Yes? That's a good question. The question is, does it always happen? Does it always progress to dementia? Not always. But there's about a 65% likelihood of progressing from mild cognitive impairment into early stage dementia. So you're about 65% likely to progress from mild cognitive impairment into early stage dementia. So you should impact right here. Now, if you don't want to go to the, oops, if you don't want to go to the doctor, if you don't want to go to the doctor, I respect that. I'm going to tell you something that you can do. But this is where we should impact. Now, these logos down here are logos of what our products do, actually, and helping to impact dementia at this level. So, in Arizona, if we had just $1 million where we could work on this, with $1 million, when we impact dementia, we can impact 25,000 lives. 25,000 lives, and we could delay dementia by 2.25 years if we caught it early enough, and we could reduce the intensity of it by 45% if we had $1 million. So let's get $1 million together now. We'll see what we can do. Is that scalable? Yeah, let me talk, it's a good question. Let me talk about how that's scalable. So this ultimately, if we had early detection of Alzheimer's, a recent article that came out through the Alzheimer's Association found that we could save the United States almost $8 trillion, $7.9 trillion. If we had early identification and intervention for dementia. So what exactly do you do? Dementia is becoming a ubiquitous disease in Arizona, in the world, in the United States, that we must have rigorous, empirically directed brain exercise programs, and they must be done during this period of normal aging. These are suggested to have a tremendous personal and societal impact. If as we do this, we have to pass the message to others. So these are some helpful links. They're on your sheet there. And I'm going to give you something, if you're interested. Somebody asked, is this scalable? And we have an online program that's very scalable. And I wanted to give you a 3-month free trial for this online program. And there's a code that you need to write down for this. So there's a code for just you people here today. And it's the number 3, The word fit, F-I-T, brain, B-R-A-I-N. Three, fit, brain. It's all uppercase, yeah? Any case. Could be uppercase, could be lowercase. Three, the number three, fit brain. If you want to do brain exercises that are rigorous, if you want to do brain exercises that are new, that are novel, that are things you've never encountered before, and you want to do things in a socialized environment, then we want to give you 3 months free to do this on our online piece. So this is online brain exercise for dementia prevention, for dementia intervention. Yes, sir. Yeah, so I think what you're asking, sir, is there a cost associated after the 3 months?
Yes.
There is a cost associated after 3 months, but usually we give about 2 weeks free. Today we're going to give 3 months free. Yeah. There is a follow-up program to this. Yes, there is. Yes, there is a follow-up program to this, and you're able to get it online if you would like. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Is there an assessment that you can take when you start it versus at the end of the 3 months to measure your progress, your improvement?
Yes, absolutely. So there's multiple assessments that take place during this process. And those assessments take place online. So you do those assessments. I wanted to really make a plug though today for the memory screenings, to get free assessments via the memory screenings. And if you have Medicare or any other form of insurance, you can get this via Medicare and any other form of insurance by going into a neuropsychologist's office. So one of the things that we struggle with is, like, we're a operator of the free memory screening day. I don't know if you guys got the flyer or there's some information that says that we have two locations in Phoenix, we're doing free memory screening for people. And I know that there's some here today. So you're welcome to do that, or you're welcome to call a neuropsychologist's office, and I can give you the number of our office if you're interested. We'd be happy to do the screen, or happy to refer you to other people. And our office number is I'll give it to you now. I didn't include it here on the presentation, but it's 480-993-3879, 480-993-3879. And you're welcome to do a free memory screening, no strings attached. We're doing one on tomorrow that's up in North Scottsdale at a place called the Arizona Dementia Center. And then there's one also on Thursday and Friday at our headquarters in South Scottsdale or Old Town. But there's also stuff that are going on here, and the AFA has also tons of other programs that you can participate in terms of getting a free memory screen. Now, if you decide not to do those, you can always call a neuropsychologist up. I'd be happy to give your referral to someone in your area if you just call my office. And what I can do is tell you your nearest neuropsychologist, and I'd be more than happy to refer you to them. And this is covered under Medicare and Medicare Advantage plans. Yes. I'm sorry. Anyway.
How many minutes a day do you need to exercise your brain?
Good question. The question was, how many minutes a day do we need to exercise our brain? And the answer is typically about an hour and a half a week. Typically about an hour and a half a week. We need to exercise, but when we exercise it, we need to exercise it with new and novel information. New and novel information. We cannot do the things that we already know how to do. That's vital. It's vital.
John, right there.
Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you recognize CBI.
C- CDI?
Is that what it's called? Cognitive impairment.
Oh, MCI, yes.
MCI.
No problem. So how do we recognize MCI? I was actually up at about 3 in the morning last night, just thinking about, you know, how that happens, just thinking about everything in the world. Somebody posted in one of our groups about how did they ask that question. And the answer that I provided at the time was, I'm not really sure exactly how to do it early. What you see is a small, subtle memory decline and attention and concentration decline at a very, very early stage. But the key is getting it really early, because mild cognitive impairment develops 7 to 12 years prior to the onset of dementia. So oftentimes, when we see people that have dementia, and we're able to diagnose this with dementia, it's been happening for 7 to 12 years prior to the onset, prior to the time we say that we have dementia. This is like pre-hypertension develops, or diabetes develops. It develops for a long time prior. I'm gonna go left to right. I think that's probably reasonable.
Is there any relationship to progressive hearing loss and dementia?
Yes, great question. So the gentleman asked, well, you guys can hear him. Yes, there is a there's a big relationship between progressive hearing loss and dementia. We must make sure that we address progressive hearing loss and make sure we address it early, because people are often left out of conversations. They don't encode information into memory, and they don't get the necessary information that they need in order to get the proper, to be able to interact socially. Two main things that help, that contribute to dementia decline. Two main things: lack of proper cognitive stimulation, and number two, lack of socialization. Did you know that lack of socialization as we get older is more harmful than smoking? It's more harmful than smoking. It's a huge, huge area. I'm gonna go, I guess.
John, we have time for two more questions.
Oh, wow, okay. I'm available after the presentation if you have some questions. So, who had their hand up first? Yes, sir, or somebody did.
I'll ask a quick question.
Yeah.
She's been asking. This brain online, is that for people with dementia, or old people like us that don't know where we are? Who is that basically?
This is for people to remember.
She gets it.
Okay, so people that are aging normally, but people that do not want to help prevent and delay the onset, the potential onset of dementia. So it's for people that are engaging normal aging, anybody over the age of 55 that would like to use that can.
That's the most with Alzheimer's and dementia.
It can be used for people with Alzheimer's and dementia at the very early stages. Yes?
Okay, so we go to this website, and then is there a drop down that shows how we can sign up?
Yes, it's very easy to use, but if you ever have a question, the guy that's in charge of it is actually here today. And his name is Sal Cody. Stand up, Sal, just for a second. That's Sal. He's in charge of all that, bringing on. He created this program, and we're not like a spaceless company. You call that 480 number and say, I'm having a problem. I asked for Sal. Sal's going to answer it. He's going to make sure that you can get on that effectively. Yes, miss.
Yes, this morning on the news, they told about 97-year-old twins. And it was all about Alzheimer's, that with these two twins, one had Alzheimer's, one didn't. Are you familiar with this?
I'm not.
Okay, and they found out that looking into the retina, they could tell a difference between the one that did and the one that didn't. So the healthier blood vessels is what we want. So even going to the eye doctor, maybe.
I think there's a lot of really interesting research on retinal activity in early stage Alzheimer's detection. I would not say that it isn't just conclusive, but I would say that it's promising.
What about craniosacral?
Craniosacral work, I haven't known a lot of research in that particular area. I gotta go, guys.
We got way, John. Just two more.
Oh, okay, good.
To the next.
I like your philosophy.
One more.
when you say new and novel ideas, does that also include different environments or excursions or learning a different
language?
Well, languages and also even an athletic event.
Yeah, absolutely. Physical exercise is huge. Learning new and novel brain activities is huge. Learning a foreign language in new environments is huge. Anything new. Now, this does not have to be not fun. This can be really fun, right? This has to be really fun. So actually, let's do things that are really fun for the individual, right? Sir?
If you would, what is the difference between a neurological assessment and a neuropsychological?
Good question. What's the difference between a neurological assessment and a neuropsychological assessment? Neurologists conduct an hour and a half neurology evaluation. Neuropsychologists conduct a 2-hour cognitive evaluation. So one is more physical, involving an MRI, that would be the neurological evaluation. And one is more cognitive, meaning that they're measuring brain function. So the neurologist is looking at brain structure. The neuropsychologist is looking at brain function.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, John will be here. Dr. Denmore will be here. He will be happy to answer any of your questions. So, John, thank you so much.